to invite Professor Rakesh Bhargava sir for his talk. So he would be presenting on muscle pedicle graft and bone grafting in cases of non-traumatic AVN. Bhargava sir.
Yeah, one moment. Let me share my screen. Okay. Thank you, Rahul. Gentlemen, in 1982, I went to Kolkata as a Johnson & Johnson fellow. We visited the Neel Ratan Sarkar Medical College and Hospital, where Dr. D.P. Bakshi was the head of the department. He treated his Myers muscle pedicle graft in avian hip and his floppy hinge total elbow replacement. On returning to my department at the Medical College Bikaner, I started practicing both these procedures. In 99, I shifted to SMS Medical College Jaipur as professor, and in 2000, we organized the Millennial Icon in Jaipur. At the conference, Dr. D.P. Bakshi gave an eponymous lecture on the use of Myers muscle pedicle graft in AVN. Dr. C.S. Ranawat was also present. He riled and ridiculed Dr. Bakshi, saying that Myers graft had been given up in Myers Center itself and the muscle pedicle graft did nothing for the AVN of the head. That initiated two changes in my protocol for management of the AVN hip. We started using the MRI to focus on the area of the affected part of the head. I found that 87% of the cases had the antero and superior involvement. And these were the cases in which we did a tensor fascia femoris graft. There were another 8% who had an anterior involvement, and there we did a sartorius muscle pedicle graft. The important thing is that only 5% had a posterior quadrant involvement. So doing a Myers pedicle graft was redundant and ridiculous. So maybe Dr. Ranawat was totally right in there. But if you have a posterior quadrant involved, a muscle pedicle graft of the quadratus femoris might work. We were using bone scan to determine our results. Why? Because it shows vascular status. It gives us greater pre-op and post-op comparability, because implant presence does not make a difference. We were putting an implant, the screws to fix the muscle pedicle graft. And results are less reliable in the presence of degenerative arthritis. That's true. The second question was the dilemma which Dr. Ranawat said, what does it do? What does the muscle pedicle graft do to the vascularity? So I started thinking whether a quantitative estimation is possible from a technetium 99 bone scan. And I found that the urologists are using their perfusion studies with isotopes, renal isotopes, in transplanted kidneys. They use radioisotope technetium 99 and spectral analysis of a triple blood flow bone scan to find out this. I had the cooperation of Dr. Karun Sethi, who was from a nuclear physicist from PGI Chandigarh, and he started giving us these quantitative estimations. So, spectral analysis of the triple flow bone scan, we standardized the procedure. First, we defined a well-defined region of interest, so it gave us a constant pixel count. We had a control area in L5 with constant pixel count. In all subsequent scans done, and we compared the HB ratio, that is the hip to vertebral ratio, in the third phase of skeletal image. The background to target ratio was also taken into account. H1 was the sum of the pixel count in both the views, antero and posterior. B1 was the sum of pixel count in the vertebral control area in anterior and posterior view. And X1 was the ratio of H1 upon B1. Readings ratios were taken post-operatively. Now, let me give you an example. X1 and the X2 ratios were compared, and they gave us surprising values. I was stunned at the kind of values we got and the inferences we could draw. It is difficult to comment on revascularization, no doubt. It did not add to that part of the question raised by Dr. Ranavar, but it became gave us a predicted value in the outcome of the procedure. This is an example. The R values are for the right hip, L1 for the left hip, and these are the values for the X1 ratios of the right and left hip. Now these are the post-op values of the right and left hip. Now, if you compare the ratio left and right hip, you get a value of 0.65 and a 0.63. Now let's see what happens subsequently. At 20 months, I compared the pre-op scan to this new scan, that is the X3. The value had risen from 60 to minus 0.97 and 0.93. Compared to the post-op scan, that is the scan, current scan with the post-op scan, the value had again risen to 1.49 and 1.49. Now, at 27 months follow-up, the post-op scan had gone down to 1.11. Now, why does this increased uptake occur? It is because of the neovascularization, because of the reparative process of the disease itself. There are two other factors. Subsequent decrease as local inflammatory reaction subsides. You see that there was a decrease in the pixel ratio. That was because there's a local inflammatory reaction subsides. Much later, it increases again. And that is when degenerative arthritis sets in. Now, this increase as the revascularization occurs or disease is contained, it continues to rise over a period of 2 years. No further rise after 2 years. That is, after 2 years, the condition becomes static. Now, what is the inference we could draw from these H2, X1 ratios? We did a lot of ratios. What does it mean? We found that if your ratio is 0.9 to 1, disease was arrested or reversed in 12% of the cases. If it was from 1 to 1.1, disease was arrested and static 42% of the patients. From 1.1 to 1.2, if the ratio was in these values, disease progressed but no arthritis developed. There were 26 patients of this type. If it was more than 1.2 ratio, the disease progressed to arthritis, and this happened in 20% of the cases. And so this is a useful predictor variable with prognostic value. We compared it with the functional results. Preoperative Harris score was excellent, good, fair in these proportion of cases. Postoperatively, it improved in 65%, remained same in 15%, and deteriorated in 20%. Now, these values are extremely statistically significant. Out of the 66 cases database that we had on record, 6 patients required a THR. They were the ones who opted for a THR. They insisted on a THR that their symptoms were not improving, they were not benefiting, they wanted a joint replacement. Now, radiological improvement occurred of one stage in 31% of the cases. Now, this is some of the clinical photographs. This patient came walking on crutches. He couldn't walk, he had such tremendous pain. After the muscle pedicle graft, he could squat, he could sit cross-legged. He's a shopkeeper by profession who sits on the floor to sell his goods. And this is what his result is. Now, radiological stage, if you see in these patients, stage one, this is by the Marcus classification. We had stage one in 9, 49 in 2, 33 in 3, 9% in 4, 5 and 6, 0. Now, change in radiological status. What change did we observe in the x-rays? 32% hips improved by one stage. That is stage 3-1 improved to stage 2-1 and normal. 43% hips remained unchanged radiologically. 25% deteriorated in radiological stage. 6.6% required joint replacement. Time after initial muscle pedicle graft surgery was 6-12 months to see the radiological change. Now, this is examples of the radiological change. This was post-op. This is 10 months after post-op, 17 months after post-op. You can see, started as looks as if it is vascularizing. 17 months, this is the condition. See how this head has almost gained a normal shape. Another patient, collapsed head, and this is how it was after 14 months. And this is what it was like after 20 months. Now, how does the radiological collapse become so contoured? You see, this happens as if you throw a stone with rough edges in a water, flowing water. After a while, you see that it becomes a pebble with rounded edges. Now, this is how Dr. Sethi used to explain that if two rough edges is, they move against each other, they will round off themselves. So this is what was happening radiologically. Post-operative complications, we had, you know, didn't have any infection, no fracture neck femur occurred. Restriction of movement was 38% due to the disease itself. Very few percentage of cases, it was because of the muscle pedicle graft. Metalgia parasthetica was a common complication in tensor fascia femoris and sartorius graft. Sometimes the lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh got retracted or damaged. Low back pain and shortening. Now, does the muscle pedicle graft work? This is the million-dollar question which comes to us. One, it relieves pain. Movements are not restored. Whatever damage has been done, it remains. It may become slightly better, or the muscle pedicle may make it very slightly worse. Gait definitely improves. Patient comes on crutches, walks without a support. Walking distance increases tremendously. Deformity in the head persists. Head eventually partially remodels and bone scan improves. Now, who's the ideal candidate? Should we do it in all cases? We have done it in grade 2, we have done it in grade 3, I've even done it in grade 4, where the patient was so poor, he said, I cannot get a joint replacement done. You do whatever you want to do. So I thought, why not do a muscle pedicle? Let's see what happens. So a young patient, ideally, it should be a young patient, no or minimal degeneration of the acetabular cartilage, crescent sign or collapse of the femoral head. If it is there, this may be a contraindication. This is not a contraindication, but you should tell the patient of a guarded prognosis. Young patients without femoral head collapse, but with extensive osteonecrotic involvement of the femoral head, combined necrotic angle of more than 2000, or femoral head involvement of 50%. These are the patients where it can be used as a time procedure or salvage procedure. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This is gentlemen, and this is my talk for you. And
please stop sharing, sir.
Yeah. Stop. I'm sharing to the. Well, how do I do that?
It is 12 o'clock. This is a red button or 12 o'clock.
Stop. I got it. I stop share. Okay, got it. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir, for very informative talk about the muscle pedicle graft. So any questions quickly? Otherwise, we have to proceed for. Yeah, Dr. Soni.
Sir Bhargav, sir, can I ask one question? When did you do your last case, this muscle pedicle graft? Last case.
Where did I do?
Yeah. When did you do?
You see, I have not...
Last case.
I have not done the surgeries for almost 2-3 years now.
And last case you did three years back?
Yeah, almost 4 years, maybe 4 years.
Okay. Means you are still doing this muscle pedicle graft?
Oh, yes, yes. If I mean, if I could do it and if I had the option, I would do it. I would still do it.
So, any other quick questions? Otherwise, we have to move with another talk.
Rahul, I just wanted to tell somebody who wanted to ask about a trapdoor procedure. All these muscle pedicle grafts were done as a trapdoor procedure. A trap was made in the neck. And in addition to making the trapdoor where I placed the graft, I would also do in a drill from the greater trochanter. Through the window, I would see where the drill was going and then do a drilling into the necrotic area of the head. And from the trapdoor, I would put in cancellous bone marrow taken from the leg crest, push it, cram it inside the head in the hole I had made by the drilling.
I think Dr. Bharti has received the answer of his question.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Dr. Porwal, you want to say something?
I want just to ask some other Dr. Goration or Amit. Just to know what comments they were like to on this muscle particular.
And yeah, Dr. Goresh?
Yeah, sorry. I did not hear the question.
Dr. Porwal, can we take this question in the last?
Yeah, sure.
Let us finish the talk first, then we can have all the questions all together and discuss the recent treatment modalities and the earlier treatment modalities. We can compare and have the comments of the esteemed faculty.